Well, I was born in a little southern Utah town in Monroe, Utah. Well, the reason I was that that's where my mother was from. And so she was got pregnant in the town of McGill, but she went over to Monroe.
That's in Nevada, right?
Yeah, that was a mining community in eastern Nevada. That's where my father was working at the time. He migrated from Monroe over there. And so she went over so she could be with her mother while I was born. So I was actually born in Utah, but I'm a native Nevadan, except for that brief period when I was in Utah. And it was it's a little farming community in southern Utah. And a lot of people from there moved over to McGill when they opened up the copper mine. And so then my childhood was all in McGill. I went grammar school, high school, everything. I was raised in McGill. And
what kind of community was McGill?
It was strictly a Western mining community. The company controlled everything. They had a dairy, a commissary, the housing, the power, all utilities, service stations, everything was controlled by, and it was typical of Western communities at that time. In fact, the plant was self-sufficient. They could mold something for it to repair a bearing. They could build something out of their carpenter shop. Their electric shop was complete. They could do any kind of electrical maintenance. And this was not unusual for these mining communities because they were isolated and there was no way of getting power or water or anything else to them. So they had to be self-contained.
What were the schools like for kids?
The schools, they were very regimented actually because again, the companies supported the schools. The teachers were all hired by the company. The schools were basically a company town. In fact, it was so regimented that I can't remember ever having a key to the house. They were all open. Any come and go as you pleased, you know. And the reason for this basically was if anybody got out of line, a child got out of line or the parent did something, why they no longer worked for Kennecott. Or at that time it was Nevada Consolidated Copper, but they controlled everything.
And you'd have to leave then.
Oh yeah,
if you didn't.
There was the housing was all company, so if you didn't work for them, you were gone. And I don't know that this specifically was the reason that the houses weren't open. I like to believe at that time people were more observant of each other and. There wasn't the fear of the crime that there is now.
Yeah, was it a sort of safe, secure environment to grow up in?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. In fact, you know, almost everything you did would some way get back to your parents. And at that time, and interestingly enough, if you pulled some peccadillo or something in school, the punishment at home was much more severe than what you experienced in school. And the teacher was God. If the teacher said something, that was it. Didn't make it, you could put up all the excuses you wanted to when you got home. It made no difference. Police, firemen, anybody in authority, that was it. And that was the way you grew up.
Were you the kind of kid that liked school?
Oh yeah, I enjoyed it. I wasn't a particularly good student because I enjoyed the extracurricular activities too much, but I was an avid reader. Tom Sawyer, Huckleberry Finn, all of Mark Twain's work. Western novels. But I read all the time, but I didn't find time occasionally for my homework at school. So I was an average student in school. But
well, you mentioned these other activities. What are the kinds of things were there to do for a young boy in that environment?
Oh, outdoor activities were really abundant. We lived in an area where there was all kinds of fishing and hunting and so forth. It just abounded. It was very close. And most of the time, most everybody, when it came to pass where you had a bicycle, where you were very lucky. But we all learned to repair our own bicycles, everything. We did it by ourselves. And we would take trips on these bicycles, sometimes 30, 40-mile trips.
You know, you've described a childhood that is in the midst of the Depression, and kids, you know, you didn't have a lot of money. But, you know, when you look back, did you like your childhood?
Oh, yeah. Really? I thought it was great. We had we organized our own baseball teams. We would build our own little diamonds out of the neighborhood. And quite often, these baseball games, we had no umpires or anything. We just, whatever we could do. So frequently, the games would end up with a fight, you know. So sometimes the winner of the game won the fight. But then 2 days later, we were back playing again. Then scouting was a big feature of our childhood. Very popular. Almost, I can't remember any of my friends that didn't belong to the scout troop and went right from, at that time you had to be 12 years old to get into the scouting. They hadn't come up with Cub Scouting or anything like that yet. But boy, as soon as you were 12, you were into the scout program. And then they had an explorer program that went beyond that. But the advantage of that scouting, where the money came from, I to this day I don't know, but we were always on campouts in the summer. And we learned to cook.
It just sounds like a marvelous outdoor childhood.
It was. And then there was a natural spring there in McGill. The water came out at maintained at 72 degree temperature year round. And we lived in that pool all summer. We'd go down early morning, take a lunch with us, stay there, swim if we weren't out hiking or something, but or playing ball. But there was all these kinds of activity. And in the evening, there was all kinds of childhood games, hide and seek, run cheaper, you know, all of these children's games. And I don't hear any of that anymore, you know. They're all stuck behind a television set. And our big deal was in the evening when Orphan Annie and Jack Armstrong came on, you know, 15-minute program.
On the radio.
We got the the code ring, you know, and the big deal that way. But that was about the only thing.
The time of innocence.
Yeah.
What were your circumstances then when Pearl Harbor was attacked?
Well, I was in high school at the time, and of course it happened on Sunday. The next day we went to school and there was a big assembly. And they called us in and the principal said, "Now, the way things look, some of you seniors might not graduate. You might be drafted. Some of you are over 18 and but the rest of you can probably look forward to a military career whether you like it or not." I'm very frank about it. Now, of course, the universal military draft had it all come in, but they weren't taking that many at the time. But then, of course, when Pearl Harbor happened, why, then they, if you turned 18, why, you were in the military. Mm-hmm. Well, most of us that could pass the exam, we applied for cadet training immediately. And if you could pass the exam, why, they pretty much protected you until they needed you. So I...
Why were you drawn to the cadet, the Army Air Corps, say, as opposed to, I don't know, the Navy or something of that sort?
I wear a pair of silver wings and I fly in the air, you know, and the songs, he wears a pair of silver wings and, you know, it was just... See, this was in 43, and by that time, Hollywood had got into the act and all the movies and everything coming out glorified the Air Force with the Silver Wing and the 25 Mission Crush and so
had you
forth.
Ever been in an airplane?
Nope. Didn't even know how you got in one for that.
So, well, you registered for cadet, take me through it. You registered for cadet training and...
Yeah, I applied for it and then I was called in. We went through basic training. And from basic training, we were sent to California, Santa Ana, California at the time. And there they screened you for pilot, bombardier, navigator training. Or if you couldn't pass, why, you went to gunnery school. And for some reason, I passed the navigation exam, and that's where I, after pre-flight, I went to navigation school. And
were you a little disappointed? I mean, it seemed like everybody wanted to be a pilot.
Well, you know? A little bit, but the fact that I'd passed and I was on my way to the cadet program, that was a reward enough, if you will. You were satisfied, you know, you'd got accepted.
You know, as you got into the service and you started moving around and being exposed to a broader world, did you realize that you were actually from a sort of a small, secure, safe little town in Nevada? And now you're in Southern California, the whole world is opening up. Could you, was there a learning curve as far as, you know, adjusting?
Oh, absolutely. Even when we took our training at a place in called Kearns, just outside Salt Lake, and after we got our uniforms and everything, we're in, I think we were there for 6 weeks before we got off the base, but then we went into Salt Lake City. Well, Salt Lake City was not that big a city, but it was awesome. My God, big wide streets and tall buildings, you know, and at that time a tall building was 20 stories, but 15 to 20 stories, but it was a gawking experience. My, what's going on here, you know? And then that was the center of the Mormon community, the temple and the tabernacle, and these were, well, just awesome things compared to what we had. And then we were moved from there to Southern California for our pre-flight training, and I got off the train, and the first thing that hit me was that smog. My eyes burned, and my nose was running, and I couldn't figure out what we'd gotten into, and finally found out it was smog. But the beaches, everything about it was just an absolutely new world.
Take us through the navigation training. That is how they turn a kid from McGill into a navigator on a B-17.
Well, you know, after you were from pre-flight, then you were sent, we went to San Marcos, Texas for our navigation training. This was a new, it was a beautiful experience because I was back in the classroom. It was comfortable. Flying was an adventure, a real adventure, but the comfort zone was in the classroom. It was a mathematics experience more than anything else, and I did well in high school with mathematics, so this was no problem. And then flying, that was just an exuberant experience. Here we're getting up and they're giving me this. I don't have to pay for it or anything. I get to fly, and you know, we flew all these missions. There were three phases to the navigation training. You started out with just a general overview, which included radio navigation. Then you went into dead reckoning, and then you went into celestial. So in each one of these phases, why, that's the type of mission you flew. But I could never understand these people constantly bitching about something, one thing or another, you know. My God, you volunteered for this, you know, and look what they're giving in. And yet, just typically, Army, I don't know, that seems to be a thing that you do when you're in the Army. You bitch about everything. But it did. I had a hard time understanding why people could volunteer for something and then be given what we were given and treated the way we were with the food we did and everything, and then still find things to gripe about. There was one incident that happened to me at, I'll never forget. We were at San Marcos at the time, and we got a new CO, and he decided that we should have some kind of infantry training, at least so that we could experience what they went through. And just outside of San Marcos was an Army base. I don't know the name of it, but it doesn't make any difference. But anyway, they had one of these ranges set up where they had to crawl through under barbed wire and across things, and they had actual live ammunition from machine guns shooting over the top of them. They'd burst every once in a while. Oh, we were crawling through there. Oh, there's some big rattlesnakes in Texas. And the cadet crawled up, and this snake was there, and he jumped up, and they killed him. The machine guns had gone off, and they killed him. And it was a huge snake, you know, but that, a rather horrible experience from that. But that was the end of our infantry training. Nobody else had to go through that course after that. Then there was one other incident, and I don't know why these stick in my mind, but one individual went out now we were in Texas, this was in the spring and getting into the summer of the year, and pretty warm down there like it is here, of course. And this guy went out and got sunburnt, badly sunburnt. He had to go to the hospital. And they discharged him, and on his discharge paper was destroying government property. That was on the bottom of his discharge paper. Dishonorable discharge, destroying government property.
Because he'd gotten sunburned.
Got sunburned and had to spend, I guess, 2 or 3 weeks in the hospital. But the word got out, you know, from whoever was there that was so. Stay out of the sun.
Well, talk about it. Eventually you got your wings.
Yes.
And probably a nice uniform to go with it.
Oh,
with
yeah. Them. Got the officer's uniform, the silver wings, and the hat with the emblem on it. And then got 10-day leave to go home.
It must have been a proud day.
Oh, it was. My father was particularly proud when I got in there. He thought this was the greatest thing, that I could be an officer in the U.S. Army Air Force. And, well, you were welcomed home like a king when you got there, you know, and 10 days of glorious fawning over it.
What was the feeling at that point about, you had a pretty good idea you were going to end up in combat at some point. What was the feeling about the enemy at that point? The Japanese, the Germans, the...
all of the Hollywood, all of the documentaries pictured them as beasts, and the Nippon beasts and the Nazi terrorists and so forth. And that was pretty much programmed into us that we were going someplace to save the world. In fact, it was getting towards the end of the war, and some of us thought, boy, this thing could be over with, especially when at VE Day, we were still in our training when VE Day happened, and we had an empty feeling, my gosh, we're not even going to get over there to fight a war, it's going to be all over with. And that was the way, it was a gung-ho type thing. They had built you up to such a point that, you know, you were invincible. They talk about the Nazi youth movement, why we were indoctrinated just as deeply as any group like that. This was our cause célèbre, kill the enemy, get rid of them, you know.
Well, you had this leave at home, you were fawned over for this period of time. Where did it go from there then?
Then I was assigned to a replacement group attached in Plant Park, Tampa, Florida. And then I took my overseas training at Avon Park, and that's where we met our crew.
Talk about the phase training and you know, where you have all these guys get together, and how did they coalesce, and how did that work?
Well, you know, it was interesting when they first formed the crew. Supposedly they were making crews up so that they were compatible. Well, my pilot was from Mississippi, a co-pilot was from Bronx, New York, the bombardier was from Upper State, New York, I was from Nevada, one of the gunners was from Chicago, one of the other gunners, the radio operator, was from in the Mideast, Missouri or Kansas or along there someplace. Another one was from Florida. So we had people from all over the United States, you know. The pilot had already had 2 years of college. The co-pilot was just going into college. The bombardier and myself had just got out of high school. The ball turret gunner who was from Texas. He was married with two kids. And you know, this was the homogeneous group that they put together for a crew. And
who was your pilot?
George F. Miller.
If there had been a movie of your crew with all the personalities, which guy were you?
Well, I guess I was the Casper Milquetoast from a small town. I was the individual that, I was a junior. I was an officer, but I was still a junior member of the crew. And they were always pulling some kind of a joke on me. And I was naive enough to fall for most of them. One example, they all got together and decided that they wanted to get me in the ball turret. And so the pilot called the crew together one morning and he says, "Now, I want everybody on this crew to understand every position." I says, "I don't expect you to do it, but I want you to know what each crew member is doing." He said, "Now, nobody can fly the plane, but you can set up here as the co-pilot and see what goes on." He says, "Ace," it wasn't Ace then, it was AC, "you're going in the ball turret this morning. You're going to be the first." "Oh, I'm 6'2", and most ball turret gunners are about 5". So they finally cramped me into there. Geez, I'm in there like, my knees are up against my ears. There's no way I could even come close to it now. My arms are there, but they finally got me in. They put through that B-17 through probably every maneuver that it was capable of, but they never could get me sick or anything. I got out of it all right. Well, that was the end of the crew training. Everybody had a big joke over it. But there was another instance. One of the individuals I met at Tampa, Florida, his father managed the, it was called the Tampa Nugget at that time, but I don't know what chain it eventually ended up, but it was a very exclusive dining area. Tablecloths and linen, and I'd never experienced anything like this. So he took us out there one night as a guest. Like he said, his father managed the place. There was a lobster pot out there, and I was looking at the lobster. One of the lobster has some way got the tape off his claw, and I was poking around, and he nailed me. And I threw my hand back up, and this lobster goes saying out the dining room, "Here's the crew. Hey, he's just done it again. Junior's done it again."
Where did the lobster land?
It landed right in the middle of a table. We went from our training at Avon Park. We were a crew then. Then they moved us up to Hunter Field in Savannah, Georgia. And that we were assigned a plane. And we happened to get a radar plane. And all of, we were going to move that over. And then we went from there to Bangor, Maine. And Bangor, Maine, we got the instructions of what we were going to expect over there. And then we flew from Bangor, Maine to Newfoundland. And Goose Bay, the weather was, this was in the first part of October of 44, and the weather was pretty bad at that particular time. So we spent about 3 or 4 days in Goose Bay. But I point this out only for one reason. We had this radar plane, and it was still top secret. So even though it was snowing and miserable weather, somebody had to be on guard on that with a 45. If you can imagine, here you're out with a snowstorm, blinding snowstorm, but still somebody's got to be guarding this plane. The German had one. They knew more about it than we did. But the army in its inimical way, why you guard this thing. Well, this was up to the 5 enlisted men. Well, the weather was so bad that the pilot got the 4 officers together and says, "Look, we ought to relieve those guys. This is really miserable. If we take turns, we can cut it down to about 2 hours apiece rather than what they're putting in out there." So we took our turn with them and guarded that precious thing, and was all in wrapped up and secured with the secure eyes only type thing on it, you know. But any, I guarded a piece of radar equipment at Goose Bay Labrador once in my life.
Well, eventually you got to take off.
Yeah.
Did you feel, you know, that's a long journey over a lot of water, and you're the navigator. Did you feel a certain amount of pressure?
Well, not really. I felt pretty comfortable, but at Bangor, Maine, the Red Cross had given us a little overseas package. It contained a darning, a needle and thread, and a toiletry kit, and a couple of other things. And then there was a little book, one of these dime novels at the time. And the title of the thing was Seven Steps to Satan. I got us off the ground, and we had to go out at night, and this was interesting too, because they'd taken our sextant away from us, and so we were flying at night without any celestial navigation aid.
It's the one time you used the celestial.
Well, I didn't have it.
Oh,
so
okay.
It was still dead reckoning up there. But anyway, I got to reading this book, and as you approach the North Pole, the farther north you get, the compass variation expands almost exponentially. For example, we probably left Goose Bay, Labrador, and navigation, the variance was probably plus 9% or some 9 degrees or something like that. And as you go north, it can approach 16 to 20 degrees. So if you leave the pilot on the same course that you set him on at 9 degrees, he's drifting north. So the sun came out, or the daylight came up, and the pilot called me and he says, "Where are we?" And I says, "Well, Iceland is right in front of us." He says, "Where?" And by this, I looked and I said, "Well, it's got to be right there. It says so."
Now, you had been reading your book.
Yeah, right? But I've been taking my fixes all the time, but I hadn't been changing the compass variation. And he said, "Well, throw that goddamn book down and find out where we are. We're in the North Sea, and it's winter." But we were about 30, 40 miles off course, and we took a hard right, and the distance was okay, but I drifted north, so we ended up landing okay. But
And these planes are traveling alone, correct?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, all alone. Going over there, you went over alone. But anyway, when we took off the next day, we got up and we were taken off, and I'd left everything the way I got out of the plane. I got in, and the first thing I noticed, the book was gone. The crew had got that book and taken it away and threw it out. We went right straight from Reykjavik to Prestwick.
Where did it go from there then?
We went by train from Prestwick down to Wales, and I can't remember the name of the base in Wales, and then that's where we went out. We were assigned to the different bases. You remember him talking about the Merseburg mission, how devastating that was. We lost 13 out of the 36 planes that were up that day. I think that we were probably assigned to the 91st to replace those crews that were missing. I mean, I don't know for a fact, but the coincidence is so striking that that's the way we happened to get at Bassingbourn.
Mm-hmm. And talk about that. Your crew was assigned to the 91st.
Yes.
And they were stationed where?
At Bassingbourn, right. England.
And the letter on your tail section of your aircraft, it was a triangle A?
Triangle A with a red stripe on it.
Mm. What did the base look like? What was your impression when you got there?
Well, Bassingbourn was termed the country club of the ETO. It was all brick buildings where the enlisted men were. They had put semi-permanent Quonset huts up, so that they were closed in, very comfortable. The officers' quarters were, the pilots lived in one section and the officers in another, and then the ground crew, or the enlisted men lived in these Quonset huts. But we had central heating, we had shower facilities, hot water. It would just, and then the mess hall was more of a restaurant than it was a mess hall. We had menus. When we flew, why you got whatever was they put you through, but in the evening, why we actually had a menu that we could select from. When you first got there, they broke the crew up, and each member would fly with another crew for their indoctrination. And I think I flew about 6 or 7 missions with another crew before our crew got back together again. The pilot was assigned to a plane and we were with him. But on my first mission, I was with another crew, and this happened coincidentally be to Merseburg oil refinery, the one where we took the real beating. We lost several planes that day, but nothing like they did before. But then after, you went through some training missions, the crew did, before they put them back on a combat mission. When we were down, we'd be flying with the other crews, but then on our down days, the pilot would have his crew back, and he would be assigned to there was a place up north of England we called the Wash, and it was just part, an extension of the North Sea. But they had checkpoints out there, buoys. So you go on a navigation mission, and they could tell if you would, when you checked that particular buoy, whether you were over it or not with your navigation log. So I think we flew 3 or 4 of those missions before.
Was it challenging in that climate, to the navigation tasks?
Oh yeah, extremely so, especially in the winter, because England would be fogged in frequently, and we'd come back from a mission, and it wasn't unusual at all to the field to be almost completely fogged in. Yeah, might have to go to another field. Then the British developed a radar system. They called it the G-Box. And it was quite a sophisticated radar system. But they had you would put the coordinates of your base, the end of the runways, in this G-Box. And then there was a couple of indicators in there that would indicate altitude and distance. And as the hairs crossed, you would be right over the end of the runway at a right altitude. And then you would bring the plane in. The navigator was doing this. And then as things were synchronized as you thought they should be, well, you just tell the pilot to cut. And the whole crew was then on your shoulders. If you read that thing right, the plane would hit the runway. But this was a forerunner to the navigation aids right now, where these jets conversely land themselves. And that was a British development. The unfortunate part about it, they had a very short range. They were only, I guess, a mile or two, it'd have to be farther than that, because we made our approach at about 4 or 5 miles away, but they were very limited in distance. You know, for instance, you couldn't be coming back from Germany and have problems and have anything. It wouldn't do you any good at that distance till you got back in.
Where on the aircraft was the G-Box located?
And the antenna was underneath, but the unit itself was in the navigator's compartment.
And of course, the navigator is in the nose of the aircraft.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And you, as a navigator, you had a workstation almost.
Yeah, a little desk. And when the planes come out of Boeing, they had a little chair there. But somebody over there decided that they could best utilize that space by using a box of 50 caliber ammunition, so that the ball turret gunner would have ammunition. So by the time I got there, the planes had no seat in there. The navigator had no seat. He just sat on an ammunition box.
And you would have your instruments, yeah. Navigational instruments.
And yeah, all of the compass and everything was right in front of you. The panel was up in front of you and your G-box. And you had a little desk where you put your maps and all that.
Would you also be responsible for some of the guns?
Well, we had one gun sticking out of the nose, but I could never, for the life of me, understand what that thing was. The line of sight was so narrow, and by the time somebody called that there was a fighter coming, and you got out of your position and got up to your gun, the plane would have been gone. They would have been gone anyway. But the line of sight was so narrow that the use of that plane to me, or that gun to me, was just virtually non-existent.
This is one of the cheek guns.
Yeah,
if you look out at the museum.
If you look at that B-17, they've got one mounted there. The navigator set on the left side of the plane. This thing is mounted on the right. Navigator was busy all the time navigating, you know, even on the bomb run, so forth. And during fighter attacks, you were still doing it, but you'd get up to that gun. But if you got away from your desk too long, why, then you would lose your trend, you know, and you could get off course if they weren't paying attention to it. So, but anyway, we did have a gun, and we were required to test shoot it when we got to altitude. And
going back to that first mission, was there a little bit of baptism by fire? I mean, you came through it. I mean, tell us, I mean, what did you experience that first mission?
Well, you know, it was a I got up in the morning and, it was, well, let's say I liken it to Christmas morning. Boy, I'm here. We're going to fly. And boy, this was great. In fact, I went to the mess hall and they had typical mess. And I was so excited that I couldn't eat. So I left. I learned later that you better eat. But we got to the plane and got through the briefing, navigation briefing, and boy, everything was just like they were telling you. This is great. Got to the airplane, and navigators had a separate briefing. So they were always out the plane. In fact, we would get to the plane, and they had actually, most of the time, the engines were actually running. So we didn't have to go through that physical torture of pulling the props through on the old B-7 or on any B-17. You had to pull a prop through three or four times, and it took the whole crew to pull that thing to loosen it up to get it lubricated so it could take off. And this is true today that on a B-17, if it takes, where they have to pull a prop through. Well, we missed all that. We'd get in there and then we'd lay everything out. And just great, you know, got on oxygen, told the crew it was altitude, this time went over, saw nothing. As we entered Germany, there was a few bursts of flak off to for another group off to our left, and I just marked it, but it wasn't anything to be concerned about. And then we got on the IP, the initial point where we're heading in for the target, and then the closer we got, well, the flak started to come up, and then there's puffing up around you, you know, and you start to realize, hey, there's something going on here. And we got very close to the target, and a plane off our left got hit and blew up. And boy, this really brought you to life, you know. God, they're trying to kill us down there.
And a very sobering kind of thing.
It was. And then about this time, flak bursts are bursting all around you. And actually, you could hear some of the dead flak hitting the plane coming down on it, like hail on a roof or something, you know. And you get off and head back, and we got out of everything. And we didn't lose anybody except that one plane that blew up in the group. Everybody else got back, but it really was a sobering experience. And, may God, what they're telling us, we're not invisible. There are ways of getting rid of us, you know. One of the interesting, this is a little sidelight, but you could always tell the first time a crew went out, not necessarily the first time, but usually the first time, and they had any kind of combat experience, real flak damage or fighters had been, because everyone had a wet pants, you know. You never even thought about it till you got back, and my God, I peed my pants. it was shocking. There was no getting around it. I can imagine what the infantry had to go through when they went in time after time, you know, because we might experience a hell of a day, but we got back to clean beds, warm meals, a bar that we could go into, you know, and we didn't have to worry until the next day. We weren't in a trench, we weren't in a tent. So, and I often thought about the horrors of that infantry where they're attacking day and night and they have to go through what we went through at just one time. So I was really happy to be in the Air Force.
Well, take us through, let me ask you, how many missions did you fly?
I got shot down on my 16th mission.
It sort of take us through the first 15 missions. As far as, are there missions that for one reason or another that stood out in your mind?
Well, of course, the first one was it stood out. And then the rest of them were pretty much normal. You know, we got up and we flew. By this time, you got to realize, this is in November, December of 1944. And we had complete air control. There just were, if there were any German fighters coming up, we never saw them. And so all you had to worry about was flak. But by that time, the Germans had been driven out of France and they were right in Germany. So they had the opportunity then of moving all their flak guns or anti-aircraft guns to their main target areas. So even though we weren't confronted with fighter attacks, the flak concentration was much heavier than it was early in the war, where they had them spread all over France and all over Germany. Well, in my last mission to Berlin, virtually walk on the flak puffs out there. It was that dark. And you've seen pictures that they've taken with all this flak. And that was pretty much at the end of the war, towards the end of the
war. Did you wear a flak jacket?
Yes.
Or a helmet or anything?
Had a flak helmet on and a flak jacket. And these flak jackets were just a vest with strips of metal sewed in them so that it covered. And they were heavy. They weighed about 50 or 60 pounds. The first 15 missions were routine, if you could say, exactly the way it was come out of the book. You went to briefing, you assembled, you flew in with the group, you dropped your bombs, you turned around and come back. The only mission that we flew that I ever saw a German aircraft was in early January of 45, and we got hit with a squadron of jets. And, the remarkable or the interesting, memorable part of that was we saw they called for the jets. Hell, by the time I got out of my seat to look around, they were gone. They made one pass through the group, but they outran their rockets. And they fired their rockets. Why, there were, you know, when they dropped their rockets, there's a little delay until the rocket picks up its propellant and goes through. So the jets actually, that early stage, they outran the rockets. So I didn't see that, but I saw the rockets go through. They said planes. I thought they were a plane, you know. And we got back and reported it, and of course G2 knew that they had started with their jet engines.
Just so that people really have an understanding of what a navigator does on these missions, you know, my understanding is you have a lead plane with a lead navigator who's leading the group. What are the other navigators doing in their airplanes?
Keep track of where you are exactly in case something happens and you have to go back. You have to take that plane back. Towards the end of the war, they quit using bombardiers. They put what they called toggle ears on. so that when the lead crane had, plane had dropped their bombs, why that toggler, so to speak, would just hit the switch and salvo the bombs. But you couldn't do that with a navigator, because if you happened to get away from the group, why, then it was up to you to take back. Or if the plane in the group, one of them, the lead crew, something happened to that plane, you'd have to move up into that slot. And at any time, you could be called on to, you know, depending on what could happen, you could be called on to move in to take the group. So you had to keep accurate track of where you all, even though you they weren't depending on your navigation, you were, and your crew on your plane was depending on you knowing exactly where you were in case you had to move up or you had to go back home for some reason. It started the night before. We had, they had, the weather was foul in both in England and over Germany, I understand. So they canceled the mission. Well, about, I guess it was 10 or 11 o'clock at night, why they come in and cut the officers' club down and everything and said the mission was back on. So I went home and I had been in a high-stake poker game and won quite a bit of money. And interestingly enough, everything in my footlocker got home except that money. And there was no accounting for that, of course. But anyway, the alert officer come in the next morning and shined the light. And he says, "You're up and you're flying." And I said, "Get the hell out of here. The mission was scrubbed." And he says, "I don't know about that, sir, but you better get down there. You're flying."
So you'd been up late, gambling, having a good time, which you normally wouldn't have done.
Oh, no, not the night before a mission. Mm-hmm. I mean, they talk about it, but generally, if you were going to fly a mission, you got whatever sleep you could. But this night, we were just having a rousing good time. And though I wasn't feeling all that good either, so I got to breakfast, and there was a typical breakfast, and I can't eat that. So I went without breakfast, and we got over to the briefing, and they had in the briefing room, there was a big map of Germany, and the target line was depicted by a string going across the different places. Well, you could tell pretty much how deep you were going by the way that string, how much string was left on the pulley. Well, they'd camouflaged it this day, and they had marked the flight plan down, but they had dropped the damn pulley down, so it looked like a milk run. And then when they uncovered that and said, "We're going to hit Big B," just a gasp went over the whole thing.
Berlin.
Because by that time, they had really brought their flak guns into Berlin, and they were really protecting that to the best of their ability. So, you know, right then, weren't like they were supposed to be, and we took our navigation training and briefing, and then they were telling us to watch the number of flak guns they expected, and everything. They were painting a bleak picture all the way through.
Do you remember the date of this mission?
Yes, this was February 3rd, 1945. I'd almost got through. I was almost coming home.
Well, take us through the mission then.
Well, it was uneventful until we got to the initial point. And then as we pulled in on the initial point, we weren't the lead group. So everybody hoped to be one of the lead groups, because by the time you got there, if you weren't the lead group, the German gunners pretty much had the altitude zeroed in. And that was pretty much the case with us. And we were flying off the lead. The lead plane was here, and we were off the lead plane. And my pilot later told me, he says, "We might not have got hurt," he says, "but I was trying to impress Colonel Lard with my flying ability." And he says, "I had that wing tucked in just as tight as I could get it." Well, when the burst that hit them and cut them in two, it actually took that lead plane, and right at where the wing attaches to the fuselage, it cut it off right there, and the plane went down, and you could see the four engines still full power and that end of that plane going down. Well, it got a few thousand feet and it blew up. And the tail section went flying off like a kite in the wind. Well, at that same time, we got hit with our three and our four engine. Well, the number four engine, they were able to
feather it
right away. But the number three engine was windmilling, and that pulled us into a spin. So we went in, and fortunately it wasn't a severe spin, but it was tight enough that you could still feel this centrifugal force pulling you against the side of the plane.
And windmilling is an out of control propeller.
Right. It's turning on its own. There's nothing to stop it. Well, unfortunately for us, the thing windmilled to where it actually burnt the hub in two and the prop flew up over the plane. And by this time, they were able to stabilize the plane enough and level it off. But we were so low then that we couldn't bail out. And we had to stay with the plane. Well, we got about 10 miles from the North Sea, the Baltic Sea, and a little place called Demmin. And we crash landed in a field.
Had there been any talk about trying to get it over the channel, or was there no choice?
I had set a course for Sweden. That's the reason that we were where we were. We thought possibly that we could get to Sweden. And I don't know. The pilot had an aversion to going to Russia. We were not that far from the Russian lines at that time. You know, here it is February, and the Russians are moving in. But he wanted to see if we could make Sweden. We got, like I said, about 10 kilometers from the Baltic Sea, and we had to crash land.
But what was it like coming? Where were you in the aircraft? Talk about the actual crash landing. What was that like?
Well, we didn't have a chance. The plane went down. That everybody was in the nose section. Well, I had been wounded. I had wounds, and I was the only one on the crew that got wounded. But apparently when that prop broke off, the heat from it, or some part of it, must have flown in and hit the ammunition box, and part of the shells exploded. And I had one pretty big one in my finger here, and one in my arm, and one in my leg, and the flak suit apparently saved my life. But I didn't even realize this until we were ready to get out of the plane. When I started to get out, I fell down, and the toggler at that time actually got me out of the plane.
A hard crash?
No, it was a relatively soft. It just kind of eased into the mud.
Did it land in a field somewhere?
Yeah, it was a German field, yeah. Well, maybe the reason when we were coming in, they were starting to put it down, the pilot and the co-pilot, and a German farmhouse come right up in front of us. So rather than crash into that, they managed to lift the plane up some way, get enough power to get over that thing. Well, it stalled out then and just flattened itself on the other side of the, and that's when I got knocked out and into the mud is when it hit. And it was just, the Germans at that time, maybe they still do, but they were using human fertilizer. And they had the septic tanks all over the place, and they had what they called the honey dippers. They'd go around and clean these septic tanks out and put them in a wagon, and then they would spread this out over the fields. And very effective fertilizer. But it smelled pretty bad, too. All of us wading through this to get out of the airplane, especially me, where it knocked me down and the mud had oozed in, and I was pretty well covered with when they took me to the infirmary, German infirmary, to treat me, got in there, and the doctor said something in German. Well, apparently he says, get him out of here. But they took me out and they hosed me down, washed me off before they took me back in and treated. Actually, he took a piece of flak out of my leg, and I still have it. He gave it to me. He says, keep this.
Well, last we heard, you were getting out of the plane, wading through the field, How were you captured? What happened?
Well, they first came up to us with a bunch of German youths, and they were brandishing those little daggers that they had, you know, and these were 13-14 year old kids. Well, they had to be younger than 16 because Hitler was conscripting them at 16 for the military. But anyway, they were having a good time with the American Terrorflieger. Well, about this time, the Volkssturm came in and chased them away and got us in, was a Stanley steamer type thing. They were actually using wood generating a steam, and this was driving the automobile. They had gone to that extent over there. They had no fuel, you know. And in fact, one way, on the way into Demmin, where we'd crashed outside of it, there was a little hill. And they made them, everybody get, I was still hurting pretty bad and they didn't get me out, but the rest of the crew had to get out and help push the bus up over the hill so it could get in. It didn't have that much power.
But. And so did you go, where did you go from there then?
Well, they kept us there, I think it was 2 or 3 days, I can't remember exactly now, in this little brig, if you will, but it was an Air Force base, a Luftwaffe base, and they had this little prison type thing, I guess, just. But anyway, we were in there. There was another crew in there with us too, but they wouldn't let us talk to each other. Then they loaded us on a plane, train, took us. First, we went through Berlin, but the interrogation was at Frankfurt, yes.
Yeah. Talk about the, well, you know, on that train, how was the train trip down there? I mean, these were dangerous times.
Well, the only time that we encountered any real problem as far as we were... I can't remember the station we were in, but the British were bombing. And they had stopped the train there, and they'd taken us off and put us in. And the civilians were really upset. And all I can say is thank God for the German regimentation, because they had been ordered to take us to Frankfurt, and they held that the Germans away from us, the civilians. And you can imagine. You know, here you are in a foreign country and you've just bombed them, and now you're getting bombed again, and here you're being protected, you know. So you could appreciate the fact that the German civilians wanted to kill us, but the soldiers kept them away. And in fact, they gave us a little bowl of gruel of some kind, the same thing that the civilians were getting in there. When they took us in to the interrogation center, they took me into this one, it was a very austere room. It didn't even have a tick for the, it was just a board for the bed, and no lavatory facilities or anything like that. And it had one little slot where you could look out into the hallway, and a little flag that you were supposed to put up when you needed to go to relieve yourself or something. But looking out, there was a courtyard, and it had a little slit there where you could look out onto the courtyard. But how they were regulating the temperature, I don't know, but at times it would get hot and then it would get cold. And this went on for a couple of days, and I guess it was a conditioning type thing. That, and so eventually they called me in. I got into this room, this German officer in there. He had a high rank of some kind, but he was dressed in a Gestapo uniform, very very proper. And he had a meal laid out in front of him. And he said, called me by name and my rank and everything. That's all I'd given him. And then he started to tell me all about myself. And he knew where I'd gone to school. And of course, this is looking back, in retrospect, it was no big deal because they had spies at the Bund had acquired any information that they needed.
And, reading newspapers and things?
Oh, yeah, sure. What I did was in the paper, and, you know, it was no secret.
But were you surprised at the time?
Oh, when he started to talk, his English was better than mine. His grammar was much better. He Well, he actually recited that he had graduated from Columbia University and had a master's degree from Harvard. And, you know, I couldn't get, why are you back here then? But anyway, he eventually laid out a little blueprint. And he says, this is a new secret weapon you've got. We know about it. And at one time, while I was at Bassingbourne, we flew a night mission. And it was very strange because we never flew night missions, you know. And we went over France, and we had a point picked out in the mid-France and went over and turned around and came back. And that's all I knew about the mission. Nobody ever told me anything else. They just said it was a recon mission, and that's all we needed to know. And apparently they had a synchronized bombing program that they were trying to institute, but it was very hush-hush, very secret, and whether it even work or not, I don't know. But
was there, to your knowledge, was there any special equipment or unknown personnel on your plane?
Well, there were several officers that we didn't know about. I mean, they just introduced themselves that they were observing us on this flight. As far as we thought, my God, we're going to start bombing at night. You know, that was the impression that the crew got. And it was a mixed crew. It wasn't our regular crew. The pilot, the co-pilot, and the navigator, and the engineer. It was all that was on the plane, plus these two individuals that went along as observers. So it was, we just had no idea, you know, and they said it's a recon mission. So we thought when we got back, we told them, we thought, well, we're going to start bombing at night. Yeah.
So this German officer puts this drawing, you thought in your head, this might be related, but what did you tell him?
Well, I didn't know at the time. He put it down and he says, now we know this and we know that you've been experimenting and now we know all about this. And it was a regular blueprint, but up in the corner, there was an insert that was missing. And it says, across it says, for top secret for select eyes only, or I can't remember the
designation. And it was in English.
It was in English. They had the diagram in English. And he said, now we understand what this is, but we don't know the triggering mechanism now. Lieutenant Johnson, as soon as you tell us that, why, we'll feed you and everything fine. I made the mistake of, if you know so goddamn much, what are you telling me for?
That's what you said?
Yeah, exactly. And he brought a big German in there, and he jerked me up out of the chair, and he gave me a punch, and I went to the ground, you know, and prod, jumped right back up again, and down I went again. And I thought, hey, you better stay down here. You're not going to survive this. I got a picture that the Germans took right after that interrogation, and it shows the marks on my face where they hit me. But that was the only time I was ever treated badly, but I guess they can say I brought that on myself, you know. And
well, after
disrespectful to this officer.
What happened after that then?
Well, then they took me back to the cell, and I laid there on the bench trying to feel sorry for myself. And finally, I had to relieve myself, and I put the signal up. God, it seemed like an eternity before he came in. And finally he came in and he told him, he says, you're a bad man. And about that time, there was a disturbance out in the courtyard. And I looked up and here, these Germans were marching in an American. And they lined him up against the wall. And pretty soon they shot him. And, and this guard came back in and says, see, that's what we have to do to bad people. And I still had to go badly, but, God, it must have been 2 hours later before they ever let me relieve myself. Well, nothing happened. Didn't hear any more about it. Well, later on, we found out it was a guise that they were using just to extract information. It was a posed thing. Nobody was hurt. It was just a German dressed in an American uniform, and when he slumped down, it was blank shells, and he slumped down. But apparently, they realized that I didn't know anything about it, so they didn't pursue it any farther.
What was your impression of the camp when you arrived there?
Well, you know, it wasn't that horrible. The barracks were almost typical American barracks, except they weren't as comfortable. The beds were, there were springs with a tick over them. The only thing was they weren't getting anything to eat. They'd come around once a day in the morning and give you a piece of black bread and some kind of a tea, an ersatz tea. And then in the evening, they would give you another piece of black bread and a bowl of soup, they called it. But later found out all it was the water that they'd boiled the potatoes in for the troops. But that was all we were getting to eat. That was the worst part about it.
Were you getting Red Cross parcels?
We didn't. It was 6 weeks before we got our first Red Cross parcel. And that was quite a relief. Too bad as Americans, too many of them gorged themselves and they lost the effect of it because they got sick. But they warned us about it. The other prisoners had been there, so by the time we got our Red Cross parcel, we knew enough to be very careful about what we were eating.
Did you smoke at the time?
No.
What did you do with your cigarettes?
Oh, they were precious. There was almost a monetary system established on cigarettes. You could trade with the German guards. You could get a potato for a cigarette. And, of course, they were taking their lives in their hands by doing this trading. If there was any, if they were discovered, I don't know what they'd do, but it was pretty severe punishment. Mm-hmm. But you could get a piece of bread, you could get an egg for a couple, three cigarettes, whatever it was. But it was a very fixed economy based on cigarettes. Mm-hmm. So I was doing quite well because I didn't smoke, but... The smokers, of course, they couldn't give it up. They still had to have their cigarette.
Was there ever any talk of trying to escape?
No, by that time, they had got the word in through the underground, however they manipulated this, to the officers in charge of the prison camp, do not attempt an escape because they were moving in to Germany. And they didn't want to have to care for prisoners or anything. They had no facilities for them, and they could slow down the invasion effort. So by that time, all of the tunneling that you read about and these different things, that had all been covered up, and nobody was attempting that. And it just everybody pretty much stayed inside the camp. Even after they moved us out and they marched us to Nuremberg, from Nuremberg down to Munich. And when we started out, they had SS troops guarding us. And for the first 3 days, they were very particular. Everything was militaristic. And then they brought the Volkstrom in, the old guard. And I think about it, but they were my age. And from then on, it was pretty lax. But nobody tried to escape because they kept bringing the information and don't escape, we'll get you when we can. But
And that's a good point, is how is the information coming in? Even back at the camp at Nuremberg, are you getting information about how the war is progressing?
Yep. But I don't know where it was coming, whether we had an underground radio or if there was some communication with the commander. Whether the Germans were giving him the information or not, I don't know. But the information that he passed down to us was pretty accurate, but it would only come sporadically. The Germans would give us a briefing every day, but it was always a glorified German briefing. We're moving on the east, we're moving on the west, and the glory of Germany is upheld and this kind of stuff. But the other information that we were getting occasionally was accurate. How he was getting it or how it was coming in, I don't have any idea. I was never privy to that.
Do you know why the decision was made to move all the prisoners out of Nuremberg?
The Patton was moving in so rapidly.
So were they marching you to the big camp at Moosburg?
Yes.
What was it like? What was your impression of the Moosburg camp?
Well, Moosburg was very disheartening because there were so many prisoners come in there. Well, this happened actually in Nuremberg. When we first got to Nuremberg, there was a baseball field, and the British were playing soccer, and we were playing softball. And we did have some freedom, but we were only there a couple of weeks, 3 weeks at the most, and they started to move the people in, and they put tents up in this area. So, and they were so close that you couldn't do anything. So almost your physical activity after that was just walking around. You couldn't, there was no place to play any games or do anything, any other activity. When we got to Moosburg, the same thing had happened. By the time we got there, the place was just completely covered with tents, and fortunately we got into a barracks, but all the enlisted men were out in tents. And on the other side of the compound were the Russians, and it was separated by chain link fence and barbed wire. And I don't know, there must have been 100, 150,000 Allied prisoners down there at that time.
Just while I'm thinking it, let me ask one question about the march from the Nuremberg camp to the Moosburg camp. Do you remember, what stands out in your mind about that march? Did anything unusual happen? Anything that you recall about that?
Well, the first 3 days, as I said, they were marching us pretty severely. And then we got up one morning and the Volkssturm was there. So we thought the same thing, but it was a very casual morning. They weren't after us to move out in a hurry, and very casual. And when they did move us out, well, we noticed this is the Volkssturm, these old people are marching us now. And generally, we had pretty much the run of the country. You could get away and go trade with the civilians for the cigarettes that we had in and the chocolate. All the chocolate was really in high demand. They had a D-bar in each one of the Red Cross parcels. And that chocolate was so hard, you couldn't cut it. You had to melt it down someplace to eat it. But the Germans hadn't seen anything like that, and boy, they would go crazy for that. And the guards, occasionally they'd see us, and they'd chase us back in and call us bad boys or something like that. But generally, the march was a very casual stroll, if you will, in the countryside. But anyway, this one day, we're walking along, and there was a goose walked up alongside of us. And it followed, for some reason, he followed along for quite a while. So I told the guy next to me, my friend, I said, I'm going to get that. We're going to have goose tonight for supper. He said, you'll get shot. I said, nah, those guys won't pay any attention. I reached down, I grabbed the goose, and he started to squawk. So I twisted him as long as I could, and eventually I shut him up and stuck him in my barracks bag. And we got to the camp that night, and I pulled him out. Well, of course, he had to do his thing. My barracks bag was covered with goose shit. But anyway, I killed it and cut his head off and defeathered it as best I could. I didn't have any hot water or anything, so I just plucked it out as best I could, mostly skinned it. Put it on a spit and cooked it. That goose was so tough. I tried to eat that tape over there. But we were hungry, and we chewed it away at it, you know.
Well, it was protein.
Yeah.
And the guards didn't discover it, or?
Yeah, they stood back and watched it. The poor old devils, they had them carrying a full field pack. They had their gas masks. They had their helmets. They had their bayonets, their rifles. And hell, you know, I think at my age, I'm 85 now. Well, these guys might not have been that old, but maybe 70 or so. I don't know how old you are. But think of trying to pack approximately 50 to 60 pounds of equipment. They were carrying their own food. They had to prepare their own meals, well, whatever they had. Well, these poor guys were just struggling. They were just lucky to get by themselves. We actually were probably in better shape than they were. So they weren't paying that much attention. You know, it was just, you know, they sent us here and hope this thing will get over with. So we were pretty free to go out. The only time that we had to worry about anything, if we got out into a little community or something, if we happened to run into some soldiers, some regular soldiers that were out there, and they wouldn't put up with any nonsense. They'd march us back to the camp, and then they'd chew the guards out for not following us.
But was it a situation? How big is this column? I mean, is this 50 guys going along, or is it as far as the eye could see?
The thing stretched for 2 or 3 miles. It was, well, there must have been, I would guess, the size of the compound and what was there. There had to be 4,000 or 5,000 or more of us at Nuremberg. And then we met up with a group coming from the north about halfway there, and they put us in. So this column, by the time we got to Germany, had to be in the neighborhood of 10,000
people. Down to Moosburg, yeah.
Or Moosburg. It had to be around 10,000 people because it stretched for miles.
Take us up to liberation, how that came about or what happened.
Well, when we got there, it was a really deflating time, because we'd been on this march for about 10 days now, 2 weeks, and we were able to trade. We got a 2 Red Cross parcels, I think, in that time. So we were eating pretty well. And then all of a sudden we go back in a prison camp and no more food and everything. And boy, you know, we knew that the war was ending, but it was a real shock to get back in there. And then to find that many people in there, and it was so crowded. The septic tanks and everything were overflowing. It was just a real mess in that. They'd crowded everybody that they could in there, you know. Well, then finally, this one morning, we got up. The guards were gone. Somebody hollered, "Look, no guards in the tower." And we could hear the heavy gunfire, the cannon fire, and then pretty soon the cannon fire from the tanks, and then the machine gun fire, and then rifle fire. And we knew that they were coming in as it progressed with that kind of firing, you know. Well, about 1 o'clock in the afternoon, there was this little town in Moosburg that had the steeple and had the swastika over it. And somebody had looked up there and hollered, and there was the flag, American flag, instead of the swastika. And you know, it just erupted, and here was, you know, there was guys, battle-hardened people in there, infantry that'd been even in Africa, and so just blubbering away, you know, just a hell of an incident, you know. And then, short time later, they tore the gate down. Too bad that there were so many people from the big cities. I'll tell you, there was a little ravine, and then a little hill, and over on that hill was a pig farm, and I'd been watching that thing ever since we'd got to Moosburg for about 2 weeks. And I kept telling these guys, I said, "Boy, as soon as we get out of here, I'm gonna go get one of those. We're gonna have a pig, roast pig." And so we cut a hole in the fence. The American officer, our Colonel Alkire, had tried to keep us confined, but they were getting out, you know, and he didn't know whether we would run into the troops or if they were still, but he was trying to keep us in the camp as best he could. It wasn't too successful. But anyway, I cut this hole in the fence, and 3 or 4 of us went over to that pig farm, and I had got a bayonet that was left from the one of the guards, and went over there. Stuck it in this pig trying to find his heart. He didn't have any other way, and he, of course, squealed, and I finally got on back of him, and I was poking this bayonet in. I finally got his heart, and I let him out. But I didn't have any hot water or anything, so, you know, a pig, I don't know if you're familiar, but they usually scrape a pig. They use hot water and scrape the fur off. You might be a farmer, Noel. But I just skinned it like you would any other animal and quartered it. And each one of us took a quarter back to the base, and got back there, and I cut it up as best I could into chops and roasts, and put it on a spit for people to roast. And you know, there was guy after I got this all cut down, what do we do with this? There was guys there that had no idea what they were going to do with a piece of meat after I'd given it to them, you know. So I built the fire and I formed a spit as best I could with the poles out of the fence and put them on and showed them how to cook it. And again, some of them, they gouged themselves and they got sick on that fresh pork.
But it was your background and probably your scouting.
Scouting is where that in my childhood, all these trips we took, we had to do our own cooking, you know, and we would kill rabbits and we'd skin them out and we'd put them on spits and we'd cook rabbits and I'd kill deer and quartered them down and I pretty much knew how to handle an animal from killing it to eating it. And then they came in and moved us out to another bivouac area. And at that particular time, they were able to handle us. They were feeding us. They were moving us out in groups by then, when their transportation was available. And they were moving us from there to Le Havre, France.
So did you end up in Camp Lucky Strike?
Yes. Yeah.
And what was it like there?
Well, here, I don't know who was in command at the time, but he didn't want all of us gaunt people to go back to the States looking like we did. So they were feeding us about 6 or 8 times a day, but a very limited amount. They were very rationed out, but it was good, wholesome food. Well, anything was good, wholesome American food after that, but it was very nourishing, and they were trying to put the weight back on us. Again, they were moving them out as they could, so I was still pretty much underweight when I got home, but on board ship, we were eating well, too.
And what do you remember about the journey on the boat? What stands out in your mind on the way back?
The first thing that stands out in mind, I was assigned to this cabin, and I got in there, and the shower was running. I didn't pay any attention. I noticed that there was a barracks bag in there, so I tossed mine up above, and I was laying there, and all of a sudden the shower turns off, and this gal steps out. She screams, "You get out of here." I said, "I was assigned here." She said, "I don't care about that." She wrapped a towel around her and went out. Pretty soon they come down, and I was gone. I later found out she was a nurse, and she'd been captured at the Battle of the Bulge. And she was in one of the forward, I guess she didn't have to be too forward when they overrun. But at any event, she was captured in outside of Bastogne or someplace along there in the Battle of the Bulge. And that's how she got there. But I didn't get to spend the trip home with her. I ended up down in the hold with the rest of the troops. And from the time we left Le Havre to Southampton, just across the channel, 90% of those guys were sick down there. Oh, that was the most horrible, fetid place I'd ever been in my life. So I took my blankets and what I had down there, and I went up on deck and found me a little place by one of the stacks. And I spent the whole trip home across the Atlantic by that stack. There was no way you could go down that hole. The stench was so horrible, you know, and those guys were reeking all the time, just wrenching with trying to throw up, you know.
Was it stormy on the way back?
No, it was calm. Oh. Hell, going across the channel, there might have been some sea motion, but I looked at it, it looked like the sea was calm to me, but just the movement of that ship, you know, this was a Liberty-type ship, and because there was no stability there like there are on liners, so all the motion was there, but all those guys were sick.
Well, what was it like to get back to the good old USA?
Well, we come into the harbor, and of course there's the Statue of Liberty and another emotional, everybody weeping and cheering and a real emotional thing. And we got to Camp Kilmer, New Jersey, and they kept us there one day. They'd given us a uniform at Le Havre, but then they re-outfitted us there at Kilmer. And the second day, you were permitted to call home. Mm-hmm. Well, At McGill, they didn't have telephones by that time. There was a communication system at the plant, and the top supervisors at the plant had phones, and they could call in, but there weren't any phones. So I called and told them who I was, and my dad happened to be working, so they could transfer the call up to the power plant where he worked, and so he got the message. And
had they known you were a POW?
Yes. Uh-huh. Yeah. I guess I've got the telegrams and everything that was sent by the War Department, and it was about 6 weeks. Well, they got a telegram in about 2 weeks that I was missing in action. The Salt Lake Tribune, which they got as a paper, daily paper, had put this up that, you know, they'd bombed Berlin and there'd been all these planes lost. So they had almost reconciled themselves that I'd been killed. And then about 6 weeks after they got, after I was shot down, about a month after they got the message from the War Department that I was missing in action, that they got the message that I was a POW.
So you came back from the dead.
Yeah.
What was the homecoming like, eventually?
Oh, well, you know, open arms, everything, big hugs, kisses, tears, and so forth. Yeah, it was first when I got home. Before that, I had met this girl when I was going to school at North Dakota, my pre-flight training, and eventually my wife. So I went back to see her, and I went back, and we got married while I was back there. And then I came back home, and there was a letter there, and I asked my dad, I said, why didn't you open it? It was from the War Department. And it says, your assignment has been temporarily advanced, the military jargon, and we will be in touch with you. Well, the tenure of the letter was that, you know, you're going to be called back right away. And this was in June of 45, and, you know, they were still moving, and they were talking about invading Japan at the time. And so we just assumed that pretty quick I was going to get called back. Well, about a month after that, I got the letter. It says, report. All I saw in there was report, and I told my wife, I said, here it is, and I handed it to her, and she says, this isn't calling you back, this is telling you to report to Santa Monica for phasing. And I looked at it, that's what it was. They sent to Santa Monica, and they had appropriated these beach hotels, and they were putting all the POWs in there. And what they called, they were processing them to get back in civilian life. And they had the wives in there. They would get into a special counseling session, and we were going into a different counseling session, and they're telling us how we were going to have to adapt to civilian life again. And, you know, we all asked, well, were we going back to service? No, POWs are not being called back.
Did you go out to Santa Monica then?
Yeah.
Ah.
They called us to Santa Monica, and we were processed. This is where they were.
And did your wife go with you?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, they were counseling them about what to expect from us being in the prison camp. And, you know, you've got to be careful because they could be very nervous. Or.
Did you feel that way? I mean, do you feel it affected you that way?
My wife said later on that I was very nervous and. Well, I can remember a couple of times we went to a movie, and the movie tone news came on, and they were showing something that was going on in the Pacific, and I got up and left, and I waited for the movie before I just waited down the lobby for her, and she said, "What's the matter?" And I said, "Well, I didn't like that," and but you know I didn't think that it was that bad, but she says I was very on edge and. Very testy at times, and especially if something came up like that. After I got out, I went back to school. I went to school at the University of Colorado and eventually got a degree in mechanical engineering. And then there was an opening at my hometown, McGill, And I went back there, and they put me on as a test engineer. And ultimately, I went up as I advanced until I was plant superintendent. I was in charge of all the maintenance and the service, the railroads and utilities and so forth. And that's where I was when I retired.
You know, at the age you are now, and when you get reflective and you think back on that whole, that World War II experience, what do you think about now with the years of experience life experience you've had now? When you look back on that young man going over there, what's your impression of it now?
I would have never had the opportunity to get out and expand my knowledge the way I did had it not been for that particular time in my life.
Did it make you a better, stronger person?
Oh, I feel it did. And another thing, I don't think my parents would have been able to accumulate enough money, nor would I have been able to at that time to go to school, to go to college. So, and I'm proud of the fact that I was able to go to school and get a degree and at least put that much of my life into advancing society, if you will. But it was a very proud time in American history. And to be part of it is, it's hard to explain, but it's a very satisfying experience to me. I wouldn't trade it for anything. I would hate to have to go through the POW experience again, but if I had to, as a part of it, I would.